In this lab, students are collecting observations of what happens when 5 milliliters of water is mixed with 5 milliliters of ethanol, which results in about 9.5 milliliters of mixture. Students are comparing this observation to observations of mixing 5 milliliters of water with an additional 5 milliliters of water, giving 10 milliliters total, and also 5 milliliters of ethanol with an additional 5 milliliters of ethanol, again giving 10 milliliters total. By comparing these different mixtures, students can see that it's something about mixing the water and ethanol that leads to the decrease in volume, as opposed to, say, the ethanol evaporating. After the students complete the lab with their group, there is then a whole class discussion to compare data across the different groups.
So I'm gonna get some class data here. We're gonna call you guys group one. Oliver, what'd you guys, for the last one, the water and the ethanol. What did you calculate? How much should it have added up to? Okay, so you used like 5 and 5?
Yeah.
Okay, and what'd you get?
9.6?
Okay. Across, Cassie, what'd you guys get?
Water and water.
So what'd you get your calculated amount was? 10? And how much did you actually observe? 10? What, Hayden, what'd you guys get?
We calculated that it would be 10 milliliters, but it was actually 9.5 milliliters.
All right.
Well, originally it was 10, and I knew that wasn't supposed to happen, so I shook it, and then it went to 9.5.
Okay. So you had to shake it up before you saw the difference? Yes, you were supposed to shake it. That's what the instruction said. So you guys did not shake it? How about who had 10 and 10? Was that Cass? Was that you guys? Did you shake it? You did shake it? Okay. Colin, what'd you guys have?
Our calculated was 10.567.
Okay.
And our observed was 9.765.
9.765. So, how small were the marks on our graduated cylinder? What did our graduated cylinder go to?
12.
It went all the way up to 12. What was the smallest mark? It went up by what? Up by ones, up by?
0.05.
0.05 or 0.5?
0.5.
Yeah, 0.5.
Okay, so it went up by 0.5. You are only allowed to add one estimated digit. So this is communicating that you had a more accurate measuring tool than you actually had. So we're gonna have to round off that last digit. So you're only allowed to add one estimated digit. Let's quick try and average these, only we'll ignore the group that didn't shake it.
It is important to discuss the group data as a class, especially when you are asking students to make claims based on the evidence they are gathering in the lab. By comparing class data, students can make claims based on the patterns of the data, opposed to just relying on their individual results. Also notice that during the discussion of the whole class data, there arose opportunities to discuss appropriate lab procedures and measuring techniques. This is reflecting the fact that students are learning the practices of science in the context of answering a question. So now there is a reason for discussing appropriate ways to record measurement or the need to follow procedures carefully.
How do you get 8.88?
It's really easy.
Okay, so.
How do you get 8.8 when
nothing
is below 9?
Yeah, nothing's below 9.
That's a good point. I should stop trusting my calculator. I'm probably missing. Oh. I know why, because I divided by 14, but we're only including 13 groups.
I divided by 14 too, and you want me to divide by?
Yep. 9.55, yes. Thank you, guys.
In the last clip, I made a silly math error. I could have easily edited this out of the final version, but I chose to leave it in the accompanying discussion where a student pointed out my error, because I think it speaks to my point about teaching this way. In a classroom where you're trying to get students to use scientific concepts and cross-cutting concepts to develop an understanding of core idea, it means students need to feel safe to take risks, make guesses, and correct their original ideas. By showing myself making a mistake and the discussion around that mistake, where I tried to figure out the cause of it and simply thank the students for pointing it out, I'm hoping to show a bit of how this classroom culture is developed. Mistakes are okay, and they are not a problem. I don't feel bad about making that math error, and I appreciate the student that pointed it out to me so I could go back and figure out what I did incorrectly. That classroom environment is really important in order to get kids to feel safe enough and take the risks to make guesses about what might be going on in a phenomenon and start to evaluate and refine their own ideas as they collect more evidence.
Okay, so what do we see? What's the trend? What we calculated the volume compared to what we got as the volume.
It goes down.
It goes down? What could have caused it to go down? Mm-hmm.
They mix together and became slightly more dense.
Okay. So they could be becoming more dense. What do you mean by dense?
Like molecules mixed together and get tighter, like a short, fat person compared to like a tall, skinny person or something.
Okay, like more packed together. So more like packed.
Bylum.
Packed in, is what you're saying?
That is not the way to get.
Hey, Mrs. So, I have my answer.
You have it?
Yeah.
Okay, the average of the difference?
Yeah.
Okay.
0.58461538 46.
So since, as we talked about with Colin, since we can only measure to two decimal points, we only want to, when we're calculating, we only want to keep two decimal points, right? Because otherwise we're saying we have a more accurate measuring system than we do. So a little bit more than half a milliliter is lost. So it could be that they're more densely packed. Any other causes? Yeah?
You said that ethanol evaporates really quickly, so it could be evaporation.
It could be evaporation.
Unfortunately, we ran out of time to wrap up the discussion here, but after students shared their class data, you can hear them start to make speculations about what may have caused the decrease in volume when water was mixed with ethanol. One student proposed that maybe it is because the mixture is getting denser or more packed, and another student said maybe it's because the ethanol evaporated. In the next day, I picked up with the discussion of these two ideas and asked the students to use additional evidence from the lab to evaluate them. For example, we saw that 5 milliliters of ethanol with an additional 5 milliliters of ethanol gave us 10 milliliters total, so it can't just be the ethanol evaporating. And then I asked students, of the possible explanations left, do they seem to align more with the particle idea of matter or the continuous idea of matter? For example, the idea that things are getting more densely packed leads towards the idea of matter being made out of small particles. After students used this lab to evaluate the ideas of particle and continuous nature of matter, we then conducted additional labs where gases were sealed inside of a syringe and students could compress the syringe. Again, I asked if we could explain those observations using either the continuous or particle model of matter. Once students had evidence to support the particle model of matter, then we got into the idea of atoms and atomic structure. In the next video, you'll see the students beginning to develop their idea of atomic structure by using evidence from Thomson's cathode ray tube experiments to refine their models of atomic structure.